This is a presentation of WCTV, all-volunteer community access television from the Township of Washington.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. I'm Larry Furrier for WCTV, the All Volunteer Access Group of Township Washington. You just saw some clips there on our robot team that we're going to be talking about tonight. We have three individuals here who are running the this program, the Pioneer Team of 1676. To my left here, we have Dan Hollander, and we have Kevin Killian, and we have Ryan Hall. Gentlemen, thank you for coming. Kevin, first question I want to ask, where did you get the 1776 from, the number?
Yeah, well, first of all, thank you for having us. We're big fans of Exit 168. We loved being here last year. Anyway, so Team 1676, 14 years ago when we began this team, we registered with First Robotics. That's the organization that runs the competitions that we participate in. And, I mean, it sounds like it's a beautiful number, 1676. We're very proud of it. It's mellifluous. It rolls off the tongue. And I'd love to say we had a lot of input into it, but it was the next number up. The team that registered the day before us was 1675. We were 1676. So, as I said, we're proud of it. We have songs that include it. And but it's we didn't have any more effort into it than that.
No romantic, would say.
No. It's very close to our hearts now, but no romantic story about how it was created.
And Dan, your job is with the
robot? I'm the electrical mentor. I help the electrical subdivision. We're basically the lifeblood of the robot. The mechanical divisions design the equipment, and then they look towards us and say, power it. Siraj is the head of my division, and what we do is we bring the robot to life.
How did you get started with this robot, Dan?
Originally, my son was a member of the team, and he volunteered me to be a mentor. I have nothing but the greatest respects. I've been involved in construction and education for over 33 years. And these kids blow me away with what they're able to do in 6 weeks every year.
So sort of people get an idea, you got nothing. There's nothing there.
Yep.
And how many weeks you finished?
Six.
In 6 weeks, we have a dragon.
Right.
You've given birth to a dragon.
Yeah.
Okay. You're the godfather. You're all godfathers.
Midwives.
You were part of this as a...
As a student.
As a student.
Yeah,
what
correct.
School did you go to?
Well, I was on the team for 4 years. I was the co-CEO for my last 2 years in high school. I graduated Pascack Hills in 2013. And then I went to University of Delaware, and I graduated from University of Delaware in May of last year with a degree in environmental engineering. And fortunately enough for me, not so fortunate for the team, but was that University of Delaware has a very long winter break, which the spring semester doesn't start until the beginning of February. And that corresponds to the large majority of the build season. So I was able to come back during college, I was able to come back in my winter break and be an alumni mentor for the team. And since I graduated last May, I now work for an environmental engineering company out in Parsippany. So I'm still on the team as a full-time mentor now.
Still enjoy. What was your function with the team? Were you on a subdivision?
Yeah. So I was on the carpentry subdivision. So the carpentry subdivision is responsible for building the practice field that Dragon practices on before he goes out to real competitions and other various miscellaneous woodworking tasks that had to be done.
And how about you? What was your job?
I run the mechanical engineering part of the team. So when we decide that we need to have a device that can grab the cube device for this year, I help mentor the kids who build that. And then it has to be lifted 7 feet off the ground, so we have a different assembly to do that. I help, guide the kids to do that part. And when we decide we're going to have two ramps on the robot that can lift two other robots, I help guide the kids to do that. I help try to lend them my engineering expertise, let them accomplish what they can, guide them a little bit if it seems like they're off the path. But I do mechanical engineering.
Okay, let's go back to January 1st now. You get your idea what you have to do.
Mm-hmm.
Tell the people how this works and what was the criteria that Dragon had to be built to.
All right, so I think a little later, Siraj is probably going to narrate the game video, which is what we all get to see that weekend. So we see what the game involves. And this year, it involved having to stack things on one side or the other side of a balance. You had to try to tilt the balance in your favor as opposed to your opponent's favor. So we knew we had to lift milk crates covered in nylon covers, and lift them and put them on one side or the other of this balance. So we need to acquire them, drive around with them, raise them very high up to 7 feet in the air to put them on a very high scale. And as I said, at the end of the match, unleash two ramps that can lift a couple of other robots that looked like wings, which gave the robot its name Dragon, the one from Shrek.
Now, how do they score? How's the scoring go about? I mean, I know you're in competition. How does Dragon fight Mistletoe?
Oh, exactly. So every year it's a different game, and this year the scoring is based on timing. As I said, you have balances, you're trying to tip one way or the other, and as long as it's tipped in your direction, you get 1 point per second as it's going along. If it tips in the direction of your opponents, mm-hmm. they start getting 1 point per second. So it's based on time, and you want to control those balances for as long a period of time as possible.
And who is the referee or the scorers or the officials that keep score? Who does this now?
Some of it's automated, like the timing is built into mm-hmm. the computer system that controls the field. But as far as things like legal maneuvers, penalties, things like that, there are six referees wearing black and white striped shirts calling penalties and fouls and things during the course of a match.
Waving flags.
Were they former people like you who were involved and who now moved into this?
Most of them are. I tell you, First Robotics is a fantastic organization that people want to continue to participate in even after they've gotten through their high school years. We have a saying on the team, once a pioneer, always a pioneer. And that's what brings people like Ryan back. There are many other alumni who, either during college or after graduating, love to come back and help the team. Ryan probably gives the most time of all of those, but we have plenty. And then there's DJ over here, whose son graduated the team, and he keeps coming back. Mm-hmm. It's such an inspiration to be working with, as DJ said, with all these kids, and just how hard they're willing to work. The kids today get a bad rap sometimes, but if you ever want to see a good work ethic and someone who's really got what it takes to succeed, watch these kids for a while.
How did Dragon do in the overall competition?
Dragon did well. Dragon was a played an excellent role as far as, like I said, picking up those cube devices and managing them. The ability to lift the other robots on the ramps was well thought after. You put together alliances of three robots when you play this game. And everyone's trying to fit together the different strategies, different robots to make a complete team. And so we think Dragon did well. We weren't real champions again this year. And a lot of that has to do with choices you make early in the season. It's a brand new game that no one's ever played. So you think that you want your robot to be strong in A, B, and C. And maybe it turns out that the champion robots were good in C, D, and E. And you just sort of missed a little bit. I think our engineering accomplishments were fantastic this year. But maybe it wasn't the absolute perfect robot to play this year's game.
And where did you have your competition? Like you have an opening round, a quarterfinals? Mm-hmm. How does that work now?
Yeah, well, there's a series of district events. We played Waterbury, Connecticut, Bridgewater, New Jersey, and Montgomery, New Jersey. The success we had in those allowed us to qualify to get to the Mid-Atlantic Championships, which were held at Lehigh University. So that was the next step up the line. And then we did well enough at the combination of all of those to earn our way to the World Championships in Detroit.
Wow.
And then in Detroit, there was there's several rounds of competition in Detroit, and I said, and we did well, but then we fell short.
So you got to Detroit.
We got to Detroit, the World Championships. Mm-hmm. Yes,
that's pretty good.
Dragon.
Now one more question, then I'll get to the young people here. Dragon went through all of this. What does he do when it's all over? Where do you? Does he go to a special, robotic Hall of Fame?
Let Ryan have
it. Farm somewhere up
space. What does he do?
A nice farm where they're going to take care of it.
Like the Kentucky Derby winner, he goes on the farm.
Exactly. Or when you hatch the chicken in science class and you bring it home and your parents want to get rid of it and they always tell you that they're going to bring it to the nice farm upstate.
No, I say home now. Right. So what happened? Do you keep them?
Go ahead, Ryan.
It depends. We recently have been fortunate enough to be able to keep most of our robots. We have a shop at one of our high schools where we have a lot of our old robots stored. But every now and then we need a part off of a robot to build a new robot. So sometimes we have to go in and cannibalize off an old one to steal some parts. But fortunately, most of our old robots are still surviving in our shop.
That was a question I was going to ask. So I was afraid to ask. Do you ever take like his heart out to put it in somewhere?
Well, no. Honestly, we do, and it can be sad sometimes because we poured blood, sweat, and tears without a word of lie into this robot. We competed with it, we cheered for it, and Ryan does say we were able to keep a good number of them, but the shop is limited, and this is our finish of our 14th year on the team, so we don't have 14 robots in the shop. We really don't have room for that.
Let me ask a question. Somebody sound crazy. After you work so many hours and days with him, does he take on a persona like he's part of the family, part of the team? He has he's an individual.
Oh, he has an attitude sometimes.
Yeah. It's like another teenager we're dealing with.
Does he get like, he's part of the team. I don't want to put him over here. Absolutely. He's sacred. And
like most people, there's parts of it that you can really count on and other parts that you never know.
It's like your car. You fall in love with your car. Your car takes you all over.
You
when it goes away, you feel a little... A little depressed, a little sad. So I was wondering, you have a place there where do you keep him? What, is he in a high school? Is he in a, where's the last year's robot?
Pascack Hills.
Yeah, it's
Pascack Hills High School.
And where?
We have our shop. He's in our shop.
Okay.
You have a high shelf in the shop. And sort of out of the waves where we don't do our work on this year's robot. And that's where we line up, some of the past
robots. Is that where you do all your work at Pascack Hills? That's where your main
That's where our main
assembly?
Shop is.
Yeah,
that's the district has given us a good amount of space at Pascack Hills. So that's where.
Nice.
So the kids from Pascack Valley have to take the school bus up to Pascack Hills during the season when we're building the robot.
Okay.
And join us up there, and that's where we all do our work.
Very good. Now we're going to talk to some of these young people who are so very bright. I can't turn around, so I'm going to look at the monitor to see you, okay? Because if I stay like this, I'll have a crink in the neck all night tonight. Give us over here, you got the microphone, so give us your name, the school, and you're a senior, I think, because I'm from last year, right? Go ahead.
So my name is Jesse. As Larry said, I am a senior. I'm from Pascack Hills, and I'm the outgoing CEO for this year and the mechanical leader.
So what does that mean, the mechanical leader? What was your job, basically?
So the way I like to explain that is pretty much anything on the robot that you see that moves, I'm in charge of that. So I personally oversaw the build of the two ramps on the robot, but I also helped oversee the build of the intake and the part that lifts up the intake and the part that makes it drive. So I really had a hand in anything that moves.
Now, next year when you go to college, what are you going to be doing? You going to be in engineering or anything? Or
yes.
Are you going to go complete? Oh, yeah? What kind of engineering would you like to do?
I'm going to be a mechanical engineer. I'm going to Rochester Institute of Technology.
Very nice. Very nice. Any challenges this year with that get, they gave you a little problem? You had to work hard on it?
Or oh, yeah.
I guess that question, everybody's going to say, oh, yeah.
Personally, we struggled a lot with the ramps this year. As DJ said, we had 6 weeks to build this robot. Week five, the ramps weren't working. Week five, the ramps, we build two robots every year, a practice robot and a final robot. They are supposed to look identical. Week five, we didn't even have the ramps on the first robot. It couldn't lift the weight of the any robot. We actually had the problem where, since the lifting wasn't internal to the system, we were lifting our robot instead of the one sitting on the ramp. So week five, we had to completely redesign, put the motor on board the ramp. That ended up solving our problem. So we got these ramps working, and I've been very proud of them since.
Gee, we got a shot now of Traeg, and he's coming. He's going to be the star. We're going to see him move around a little bit and do a couple of things,
absolutely.
Right? Well, thank you very much. Want to push that? Give us your name, the school you go to, so they'd be very happy to hear what school you went to and the year you're in.
All right. Well, hi. My name's Tyler. I went to Pascack Valley High School. I'm a senior. This is my third year on the team, and I have two main roles in the Pascack Pioneers. I'm along with Jesse. I was one of the designers of the ramp mechanism, and I'm also the drive coach of the Pioneers.
So you did the ramp. I saw it when you come in. How difficult was it to make that ramp work? Did you have to get a lot of help from our friend here, DJ? Or
yeah.
No.
It was very difficult. It involved a lot of math and physics in order to figure out what types of motors we needed to lift the ramps, where the motors needed to be placed in the ramps, what types of legs do we want to use, what types of wheels do we want to use to allow the ramps to lift. So it involved a lot of help and a lot of brains put together. But it all worked out in the end.
Yeah. You lost me when you said math and physics. I was lost, totally lost. I wouldn't be able to hand you a screwdriver. Well, maybe I could do that. All right, thank you very much. We're going to move down to our next gentleman here, and you are?
My name is Siraj.
Okay.
I'm also a senior at Pascack Valley High School. On the team, I am the other outgoing CEO. I'm in charge of the electrical subdivision as well as the scouting leader on the team.
Oh, you got a CEO, eh?
Two of them, one in each school.
Well, very good. And as a CEO, you oversee everything?
Yeah, so our job as a CEO is to make sure that every goal we have as a team, we accomplish. Everybody's doing their job, and everybody's happy on the team with what they're doing.
Now, as CEO, when Duncan was in the middle of this Mortal Kombat to win, were you nervous? Were you sweating, your hands wet?
A little bit, yeah. As a scouting leader, it's my job to stay in the stands and watch every single match. So I know how other teams are doing. I know how our robot goes, and we've put so much effort into it. So when you go into a match, it's a little nervous. Like, you know, you want to see it do really well, and you just hope that the drivers and the drive team does their best, which they always do.
Okay. Now, do you have a clip that you want to talk about? Ricky has a clip. You might be able to just chalk over the film what we're seeing now, okay? Because you know what the clip is, right?
Yeah.
Go ahead.
So this is the game animation. We get this the first Saturday in January, and this is what first shows us how the game is played. So it's a 3v3 game. There's a red alliance and blue alliance, like you say. Like Mr. Killian mentioned before, there are two different balances on the field, or three different balances. There's the switch, which is the lower balance. There's the scale, which is the bigger balance in the middle of the field. The goal of the game is to get those yellow cubes into the balances on your side. So in the first 15 seconds of the match, robots start with cubes inside of them, and there are cubes placed on the field, as shown in the video. The drivers stand behind a white line, and then we go into an autonomous period in the match. And before the match starts, the plates are randomized as to which color they are. Robots then use pre-programmed instructions to try to cross a baseline, which is a gray line on the field, as well as score those cubes that are preloaded into them, into either the switch or the scale or both. A major goal in the first 15 seconds of the match was getting all three robots across the baseline, as well as getting one cube into the proper side of your switch, which is the lower balance. After that, the drivers take control of the robots, and then drivers are responsible for getting those power cubes, those yellow milk crates, into their own side, scale, or switch. So you see a small robot over here putting the cube into the blue side, because it's a blue robot on its own switch. And you can see this robot over here pushing the cube through something called the exchange. Part of the game was getting the cubes through the exchange to a human player, and a human player could push it back onto the field or put it into a vault. Now, the vault has three different sections. Each section provides a different power-up. There's force, levitate, and boost. When you press force, it gives you control either of the switch or the scale or both. You can see the animation right here. One cube into that vault will give you control of only the switch, two cubes to scale, and three cubes, both of them. For boost, it doubles the amount of points you get for 10 seconds on the switch or the scale or both. Levitate gives you one robot on your line to free climb. In the last 30 seconds of the match, they want all three robots to climb up a very narrow bar, and you had to be up about 12 inches off the ground. There's a little brick pattern on the bottom, yellow bricks that they use as a marker. It was very hard to get all three robots up above that section, so like us, we had robots that were able to help robots get up above that platform, and we used the levitate ourselves. There's some robots that actually climbed and had robots grab onto them. The different methods of how robots were able to get those points for all three robots climbing.
And you get this all done in 6 weeks?
Six weeks.
Wow.
I mean, figure out what the heck they're talking about, decide what we're going to build, and then finish it.
Wow. All in 6 weeks. And how many days a week do you work? Look, you must work 24 hours a day every day.
Pretty much.
How long do you work there?
So during the school week, which is Monday to Friday, we come right after school, usually at the school at 3:30. That's when we start. And we'll go until about 9, 10 o'clock at night. We'll go on Saturdays from like 8 in the morning to 4 in the afternoon. And as it comes closer to the end of the season, when we really need to get a lot of work done, we'll go later. You know, we'll do the 11 o'clock nights. We'll do Sundays. And the night before bag day, which is the day we have to bag up the robot and we can't touch it until our next competition, we're there basically until midnight, putting the final touches on the robot, having our driver practice with it, just getting as much time as we can with the robot before it goes in the bag and we can't touch it for a while.
Tremendous amount of time. And on top of that, you have your schoolwork you have to take care of, right?
Got to keep up with that.
When do you fit that in? What, 2, 3 in the morning?
We find time during the day. I own my own sub-team electrical. We do a lot of our work towards the end of the build season, so I'm able to get a lot of work done, you know, bigger projects I can work on during the beginning of build season, and a little homework here and there I can do in the morning.
It's two full-time jobs.
Yeah.
It's two full-time jobs.
It really is.
What you're doing is two full-time jobs. It's amazing.
And one of the things that's really good about the kids helping each other is the older, higher-year kids are helping the lower-level kids, like the freshman and sophomore. Okay, I took that class, I'll help you, I know what that. And they have like a built-in tutoring system already built in that they're all helping each other.
And you're also bringing in freshmen coming
in. Yes,
absolutely. And so it's always, you always got a nice feeder class coming in to go on for the next year to replace the seniors who leave.
Right.
So I know it's tough to replace you, but I mean, we have to replace. Yeah, right. Although you could always come back.
And in fact, we help to mentor and assure the success of some Lego robotics teams in the middle school that send kids to our schools. So again, that's sort of like the minor leagues helping to feed us.
Wow, that's great. Okay, any more clips you have, or this is it?
That's the game animation. We have a few match videos. If you want to see that a little bit later, and we can narrate that as well.
Okay, want to do that afterwards, or want to do it now?
We can do it after.
Okay, we'll go around, we'll come back to you. Okay, let's go. We'll take their names and your name, your class, the school you go to, and the grade you're in.
I'm Hannah. I'm a junior at Pascack Hills.
And what was your function with the production of this dragon robot?
This past year, I was the co-leader of the Management Outreach and Design Division. So that basically means I was in charge of keeping track of the graphics, the website, all the award submissions, and the outreach events that our team does.
Wow. Any difficulties with that?
It's just a lot to keep organized because we have a lot of outreach events, even international ones. Uh-huh. So just keeping in contact with everyone and planning everything is important.
You're constantly on the computer then?
Yes.
You got a kick out of when it was all done. You sat there. Were you nervous like I asked when?
I think the whole team really gets invested in it because we're all together so much. So it's important for us all to keep track of everything.
Very good. Okay. We'll move down. You know the routine. Your name, the school.
I got it at this point.
Yeah.
I'm also named Hannah. It's a bit difficult at times. I am a sophomore at Pascack Valley and the incoming Valley CEO. Have big shoes to fill following after Siraj. I was on the electrical subdivision and also the presentation team this year.
And what did that entail, basically? What did you have to worry about?
Presentation team?
Yeah.
So FIRST does a great job of really acknowledging all of the hard work that students like us put in throughout the season, whether it be robot, outreach, as Hannah was talking about, all of that stuff. And my job, essentially, was to tell everyone how amazing we are. So I got to go around, meet amazing people, talk to different judges, most of which were FIRST alumni, and really just tell them about our team and everything amazing that we do.
like almost like a PR, doing a lot of PR work.
Yeah, essentially.
And talking up Dragon over here, right?
Oh, yeah, and everything else.
And everything.
For example, as Hannah said, we do international efforts. We're working with schools in Ghana, South Africa, India. So I get to tell people all about that and work a lot with that, and it's really amazing.
Wow, very good. Congratulations, you did a great job.
Thank you.
All right. You know what to do.
I know what to do. I'm Sean. I'm a junior at Pascack Valley. And during the build season, I'm on the carpentry subdivision. And in the competition season, I am on the drive team. I'm the operator, one of the two drivers of the robot.
You drive the robot?
No, I'm the operator.
Oh, the operator. I'm sorry. What does that entail, operator?
This year, I controlled the ramps. I dropped them down onto the platform, lifted robots up. I controlled the elevator. I lifted that up. And then we have a four-bar mechanism with our intake on it, and I controlled how high that went.
And you do this during the competition?
Yes.
Do you practice a lot doing this with the raising and lowering? Is there a lot of practice go into it with the team?
This year, we tried to practice, but there just wasn't too much time since we were constantly working on the robot. But for however much time we have with the robot, we try to get as much time as we can driving and practicing before our competitions.
Now, here's a question anybody can answer it. From the time the robot is finished until you have your first competition, what's the time frame?
This year, it was 2 weeks.
We had 2 weeks to take out the kinks and then to, I want to use the word practice if that's the correct word.
Well, no, it is, honestly. Jesse mentioned it a little while back, and there's a lot of information coming out here, but we actually built two robots. So you heard...
Wait. You built two dragons in 6 weeks?
Yeah. Well, the second one wasn't named Dragon, but...
Well, whatever his name was, Mrs. Dragon.
So Siraj mentioned on the what they call bag day, we have to put Dragon in a bag with a tamper-proof seal so that it proves we didn't work on it at all from that date until our first competition. But we still want our drivers to get driver practice. We still want our programmers to work on maybe enhancements to the programming. That's what the other robot is for.
So you built two robots. Going to be, a practice robot.
It is a practice robot.
And then the real McCoy is...
The practice robot and the competition robot.
Hermetically sealed.
Yeah. Right.
Basically.
Right.
Simple two of them.
We do. So that's again. So the other one is for practice again for programming development and things like that.
Where's he now?
He's
don't tell me he's in parts all over somebody's desk.
He will be soon.
Pretty much.
Because now that we're done with the formal competitions, we don't need to put him in the tamper-proof bag anymore. So if we have to do anything with the robot, we'll do it with Dragon. We don't have to do it with the practice robot. So the practice robot's kind of outlived his usefulness.
What do you do between now, May 18th, until January 1st? What goes on with the team?
Someone want to take that one?
Anybody want that question? Oh, here we go. Go ahead.
Thank you. New CEO, getting her work in. we do more outreach events, as we were talking about, and a lot of what we do is recruitment. So I know you mentioned before the freshmen, getting them in. And a lot of what we do is going out, putting ourselves out there, trying to get more kids interested in joining the team, and also, kind of showing what we do and showing off how proud we are of all the work we put in during the season. After the season, we still have kids showing up. This is basically the core group who comes every single meeting, regardless of whether they have to be
so
there.
So what we're doing here is part of your outreach program. People will see this show and be interested. I know we got a lot of feedback, positive feedback, that how well this was done and how bright these kids are. So we're going to run this. It's going to be on the internet. We'll tell you where they can go get it and you can watch it. Okay, let's go down.
I forgot the gentleman again.
Let's go one more down. You ready? Okay. What happened here? You know, name, dress, serial numbers.
My name is Michael. I am a junior at Pascack Hills, and I am in charge of all the programming for the team. So I'm the one who writes the code for the robot to make it actually work.
Oh, you put the program in
there. Yeah.
And how long did it take you to write the program?
Well, so...
Like, I know what I'm talking about, write a program.
Much like Siraj said, programming and electrical both do their work mostly towards the end of the season. Because, it's my job to make sure everything that was built works, but I obviously can't do that until the thing itself is built. So usually we start actually getting to a lot of the programming about, week three. So we have, 3 weeks of build season to program. And then additionally, because we have the practice spot, we have, an extra, 2 or so weeks afterwards to work on it.
Okay, very good. And how do you program? What do you put into it? How do you do it?
So we have this program called LabVIEW, which is basically the language you program in.
Okay.
It's basically organized sort of like a flowchart almost. So it's very easy for rookies and anybody else to collaborate and learn it. So basically the way we do it is we just write the programs on there with the flowchart system, and then we just load it onto the robot, and hopefully if it works well, it works.
Good. When this show's over, we repeat the show. I'm going to listen to what you said again. Maybe twice.
Well, normally our head coach, Jack Theodore, who unfortunately couldn't be here tonight because his daughter's graduating college.
Oh, I should have been
here. Congratulations, Allison. But yeah, he's also a programmer, so he's the head of that subdivision. So like what we said before, with each of us with our areas of expertise, we lend that information to the kids, and we help them, and then we stand back and watch them do it.
Okay. We got another clip you're going to talk about. Yeah. So why don't you pass the microphone down, and you got a chance to take it again. Yeah, just competition. This is the actual competition now, right?
Yes.
All right, take us through it.
This is a district championship. You can see the six robots on the field, the first 15 seconds of the match. They're going over that baseline, that gray line, trying to get cubes into the switches. We're on the blue side, just put a cube into the blue switch.
This is actually happening now, right?
Yeah, this is happening. Now we're going into the teleoperated period, where the drivers take control. And each robot has a different task in this game, and we decide those tasks before we go into that match. So you can see there's different robots trying to go onto the scale, which is the bounce in the middle, the tall one. We're focusing mostly on the switch, which is towards our side. And then there's going to be a robot that's going to be focusing on the exchange, which is, you can see a little blue and red cube towards the walls. There's an opening right there to push the cubes through. And both robots are trying to gain control of their own switch and scale. So you gain 1 point per second if the scale is in your favor. As for the switches, you get 1 point per second if it's in your favor. If it's not in your favor, it's neutral or in the opponent's favor, you won't get any points, but they won't get any points either. Whereas with the scale, if it's not in your favor, it's neutral, nobody gets points. If it's in your opponent's favor, they get points. And that's when the multipliers come in, the boost and the force. You want to try to get a boost or a force when you know it's advantageous. You know, trying to gain control of the switch or the scale, trying to boost the amount of points you're getting because you might think your opponents are trying to take control of it soon. And you can see near that blue platform, there's a red robot playing defense on us. This game, defense was also part of the game. You know, it was big to see other robots trying to stop some robots from getting the power cubes into the switch or the scale so that they couldn't gain control, and it put their own team ahead so they could gain control of the switch or the scale. We're about halfway through the match right now, and as we get to the last 30 seconds, that's when robots are going to try to climb. They're going to line up right now. You can see us going towards the center of the field with a blue robot right in the center lining up on that blue platform. So with the last 30 seconds of the match, we're going to line up right in the center. And we're actually going to deploy our ramps down. And this is to allow other robots to climb on us. You can see we have one ramp deployed. We got a little stuck on one, but we're able to bring it down. And now two robots are going to climb onto us. They're going to back up onto us. We found that having robots back onto us instead of driving straight on was much better. And now we're going to lift them up above that mark. And we actually got three cubes behind the driver walls to put into the vault to give us the levitate. And that's the power-up that gives us a free climb. Now the match ends. You can see each robot is on the platform. Some didn't make it to the platform with that one red robot over there. And now the refs are going to score the points. And basically, they get a score. And then we'll get them points, and that's how we're ranked.
Unbelievable. How long does the match last when you up against another robot?
It's 2 minutes and 30 seconds.
2 minutes and 30 seconds. Now, we have another clip of a championship we're going to go through.
Sure, yeah.
And would you like to take us through that?
Sure, absolutely.
Here we go. Give us a little preview and then talk what's going on.
So this is at the championship. We're on the Tesla subdivision. There are six
What color are we?
In this match, we are also blue. Okay. We are on the far side.
Here we go. 21-0. Oh, no, he caught you.
Oh, yeah. So right now, the robots are going to put cubes into the scale and the switch. We have one robot on the blue side actually putting two cubes into the switch. At the championship, robots have gotten much better. Their pre-programmed instructions, they're able to do a lot more. Now you can see different robots trying to go for the scale and switch like in the last match. One thing to point out on the top of the screen, that's where spectators can see what points are being scored, what game pieces are in what areas, the scales are in the switches, are they in favor of the red side, the blue side, and the circles show how many power-ups the team has used. the little number will show how many cubes are into that power up slot, and then if the the bigger circle actually turns either red or blue, it'll say, oh, that team used that power up. So right now in this match, our role was to get the cubes that were sitting right behind us and put them into the vault, because we want to fill up the vault and get all 9 cubes in there to gain points. You get 5 points per cube inside the vault plus the power-ups and boosts they provide. So that was a really important part of the game. Our alliance partners, they're going to be focusing on keeping control of our own switch, which is the lower balance, as well as making sure we control the scale, which is the higher balance. And you can see right now in the spectator UI, we actually have control of the switch and the scale because the little circles are both blue. And the little boost logo comes up, meaning we are now getting 2 points per second for both the switch and the scale. Now you can see also a yellow dot above the blue spectator UI. That denotes a ranking point. Important part of ranking in this game was earning ranking points. You were scored by how many points you got average per match. Like I mentioned before, passing that gray line in the front of the field and getting a cube into the switch earned you 1 ranking points. Getting all 3 robots climbing was another ranking point, and winning was 2 ranking points. So you can see the last 30 seconds of the match, we drop our ramps, and our 2 alliance mates are going to climb on top of us. Like I said, they're going to back up onto us, and you can see on the bottom views, the different views of the robots actually getting on top of us. And then with 18 seconds left, we're actually going to lift the other teammates up. And this worked really well, because in case a teammate need to go score last minute points, we can have a ramp down, they can quickly go on. We had a lot of extra time in this match, but if a teammate need extra time to go score extra points, we could allow them that time. And that's the end of the match. And now the refs are going to go in, they're going to score and tally up the points.
So you won that match, and that was like a regional championship? Or
the world championship.
Yeah. Regional?
That was
world.
World. That was okay. World. So it was a qualification match, is working our way through the world championship.
Wonderful. That's unbelievable. Did a great job.
Thank you
very much. Now we get this, the star of the show. We'll have Dragon. He can do a couple of things for us on live TV, right?
Yeah.
Okay. All right. So why don't we bring Dragon out and... let him do a couple of things, and don't take me away, though, you know what I mean? All right, so I see you got your controls over here right in front of us there. Mm-hmm. Okay, where's... and we'll see Dragon.
All right, so they're gonna get the robot booted up here.
Okay.
And, so Jesse is going to be helping to, you know, be over there by Dragon, help narrate, and Michael and Sean are going to be driving it. And Siraj is going to be describing a little bit about what Dragon's doing. You guys ready to go?
Yep.
All right.
Is Jesse going to be talking? Maybe she needs a microphone.
Siraj's going to be talking.
Okay, go ahead.
All right. So right now we have our 4-bar mechanism going down, or elevator going all the way down, so we can get the cube. We have 4 wheels that are part of our intake, so that they spin inwards, and then we can drive into the cube to actually get it inside our intake. Just like that. Now that's fully in, we can raise up our 4-bar if we want to go for the switch, which is the lower balance. We don't need to go that high, so we can just use the 4-bar mechanism. And the 4-bar mechanism is actually made of carbon fiber, so it's lightweight but also really sturdy. And that way we can get above the fence that's around the switch. Now say we need to go a little bit higher to get to the scale, which is about 7 feet up in the air. We have our elevator. The elevator can go all the way up to the 7 feet it needs to go to. We're not going to go, of course, all the way here just to not hit the ceiling. But once we go all the way up there, we can align ourselves. We have a camera right in the front, right by the intake. That way the drivers can see, oh, I'm getting close to the platform. I need to go left. I need to go right. We have 6 wheels on our robot. It's a tank drive robot, meaning each side is controlled individually. And we actually use almost like the sticks you'd see in an airplane, those control sticks, the games you play in an airplane. So that way a driver can control each side individually, and to turning, you would reverse the positions you're doing the sticks. So you put 1 stick forward, 1 stick back. So the robot can also spit out the cubes when we're above a certain height, just like that. And then you can go back down to get another cube again. And like you saw in the last 30 seconds of the match, our robot was able to deploy our ramps so we can get other robots to climb on top of us. To do that, we had to lift up our 4-bar a little bit, and then we deploy 1 ramp for you right now. Say that. Bit loud. fun fact about our robot. So we're trying to figure out what we wanted to use as a latching mechanism to hold the ramps up. Originally, we had gate latches, using different things. We had a mentor this year, new, who worked at BMW, and he said, you know, this is the perfect opportunity to use seatbelts. So we actually have car seatbelts holding up the ramps on each side, and we have little servo motors pulling down the buckle, almost like you'd push to release a seatbelt, and that would allow the ramp to fall down.
I know, you showed it to me prior to the show that you had seatbelts. So. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. And now robots can climb up the ramp, and then once the robot is up the ramp, they're able to lift up the ramp to get above the 12 inches.
Jesse,
lift it up.
Lift Jess.
Jesse's going to be our robot for this demonstration.
About the same man as a robot.
Jesse.
There we go.
Now you got to get it down. Oh, there you go.
This doesn't go back down.
We have the ramp set up so that we can have just the operator click a button, the ramp will go, and will stop automatically, so we don't have to worry about, oh, the legs don't go too far and the ramp falls back down. We want to make sure it's as easy as possible for the operator and the driver to drive the robot, not have to worry about these little things.
Unbelievable.
I mean, it's really impressive what the programmers get to do on this. Like I said, go just far enough, but not too far. And I made a comment before how the programmer, you said, how long does it take? I said, it's still not done. And that's one of the things about the robot is you're always looking to improve it. And it's tough to build a new mechanism, but it's a little easier to say, I can make that program a little better. I can work that a little faster. I can be just, you know, and we did throughout the entire season. We kept improving the robot from our first competition at Waterbury to the next, to the next, to the next. It looked much better as we were going along, even though it had all the same mechanical apparatus, thanks to further advances made by our drive team and our programming team.
Wow. How is he different from last year and the year before and the year before? How's it different?
Well, again, it's a completely different game every year. One year, we had to pick up foam basketballs and shoot them into a basketball.
I remember that. Was that last year?
That wasn't last year. That was a few years back. Another year, we had to do a soccer ball. I think we might have talked about that one last year as well. Last year, the balls were wiffle balls about the size of a softball, and they were plentiful, and you had many of them, and you tried to shoot them in a goal. Meanwhile, you had to also be picking up these gears and run them back and forth, and then you had to climb up yourself on a rope at the end of the match. Completely different skills than picking up a cube like this, which is why it really is a brand new brainstorming experience every single year. Some things you can carry over from learning from a previous year. You know, if you build a chassis that drives well, that's a pretty reliable thing, and you work off of that platform. But there really are new things you have to develop every single year.
How long have you been involved with the robots, building these robots? How many years?
I've been involved all 14 years of the Pascack Pioneers.
And Dan?
Six.
And?
This was my ninth year.
Okay, how has it changed in 10 years, the robots?
The
What's the biggest change?
The biggest change in the... Well, the robot's mostly the control system. We're using more sophisticated sensors, and the program is able to do more. So as far as the robot goes, that's the biggest change. For the team, we've still been building robots. We've been building robots for all 14 years. The biggest change on the team is, I think, a lot of the outreach that Hannah and Hannah were talking about earlier. One of the things that they didn't quite get to was we're very proud of a program we did with the University of West Virginia, where we built a robot that can help disabled, differently abled kids kick soccer balls. So we went down, we designed this robot over a couple of years, and we delivered it to the University of West Virginia. And we went down there to what they call an adaptive phys ed class, which are kids who can't do the normal kind of sports activities. And we went to that class, and we delivered it, and it was so heartwarming to see these kids who couldn't participate in athletics before actually be able to kick a soccer ball, enjoy that activity. So we built a robot in conjunction with an alumnus of Pascack Hills High School, who's a professor of phys ed down at the University of West Virginia, teaching her college students, how to, when they grow up and become gym teachers in high school, how to get everybody involved.
It's amazing. As you talk and as we see Duncan, this show that we're doing gets more and more amazing. It's just, it's beyond, I mean, what you've done, and now you talk about what's done at West Virginia.
Yeah.
It's just an amazing. What do you see down the road? What's next for these robots? Can you envision anything, or it's...
The main thing I'm excited about down the road is more people like Ryan. We have more alumni coming back to the team.
It's putting pressure on you now.
Yeah,
the pressure
really is.
Oh, boy. I mean it. We, everybody thinks we build robots, but we don't. We build kids. And seeing them come back and help the team out and the skills they've established, graduating engineering careers, science careers, whatever it might be, business careers, that's what I foresee. Is I foresee more kids coming back and us having, you know, a swarm of alumni coming in and helping the team out and just having so much excellent examples set for whoever the current team members are at that point. That's the part that warms my heart the most, is when we have dozens of kids coming back who used to be on the Pioneers.
And those kids, their enthusiasm will make advances, more advances,
exactly.
More advances.
Exactly.
So that when you look back, you say, oh, I remember the first robot we had. It's like, God, that was, compared to today, this is unbelievable how fantastic it is. We look at Duncan here and you say, wow, this is unbelievable what you did in 6 weeks. Need the two of them.
Yeah, I mean, I'm looking forward to our footprint growing and growing and growing. That's what I see.
Yeah, can you get one to bring me a beer during a football game? And That's coming.
Oh, yeah.
That's coming.
Yeah, for sure.
Well, I think the thing, too, is the kids are learning more than just how to build a robot. They're learning skills and abilities that American industries are looking for.
Mm-hmm.
Employers are looking for people who know how to do things on deadlines, how to work together as a team, how to solve problems. This is all part of what FIRST teaches these kids. You know, we're developing the future corporate leaders, designers, engineers in America are coming from FIRST teams. And that's really, I think, the key of what we're teaching these kids is how to get things done. Not just, you know, the robot's the fun thing we're trying to do, but we're trying to teach these kids this is what you need to be successful in life, and that's what we're trying to do with them.
As a student who graduated from the team, went through college, now works for an engineering company, I can't tell you how invaluable all those skills that you learn throughout the team are. You learn how to be a good team member in a multi-discipline group and team, and that's so valuable for you when you go to college and have to work in groups, or then you end up working for an engineering company and work with all these people from different backgrounds and different ideas, and learning how to work together well in high school, it sets you up so much better than everyone else when you get to those stages of life.
You guys have just amazing what you do and what you impart, and you've planted some seeds along the road, and now they're beginning to flourish. We're seeing big and big trees. It started small. Pretty soon we're going to have oak trees because of what you did.
Well,
Jesse's
still small.
No, she might be small, but she'll have a big oak there. Like I said, we did the show last year, and we got a lot of responses coming back, and mm-hmm. people are watching the show, and they say, that's unbelievable. It makes you feel good that you have young people like this, knowing mm-hmm. that our future is in good hands. And you guys started the ball rolling. Mm. So I want to thank you. Mm. And you guys enjoy coming up here again? You had a nice time?
Yeah.
You can come back next year. We can bring you back. And I want to thank you. This was a great show. We want to thank Duncan. And as he goes into retirement, mm-hmm. and now you get to take a little rest. And before you know it, Christmas will be over, and January 1st, you'll be sitting down for your new project, and I want to invite you next year in May when everything is done. You have a standing invitation in May to come back with your next robot and mm-hmm. discuss what that robot did and all the intricacies of going into it. Mm-hmm. Okay, so we can put you down. Okay. You'll see me every week, remind me.
See you every Sunday. I think that we should have you come to our shop someday and see what see what's all about.
Action 168 on the road.
Yeah, that might be a better.
Action 168 goes to Action 173.
What would you want me to do?
You can
stay out of the way.
See all these kids hard at work.
I can do that. I can say I'm watching down. She's way out of the way.
Yeah.
But I'd like to come by and see the shop. Maybe mm-hmm. bring mm-hmm. Ida with me and Ricky will shoot some of the film.
Yeah,
maybe next year we'll shoot it before they come in and see the shop so people get an idea.
Yeah, that would be a lot of fun.
That'd be nice. Yeah,
we'd love to have you.
Oh, great. Thank you so very much.
Absolutely.
I really enjoyed it. It's a great show.
Thank
I learned a lot. And I will watch this 2 or 3 times to see what you said. I don't know, you know. And if I don't understand, I'll ask Dan. He'll explain it to me on Sunday, okay? Dan, what did he really say? Okay, so thank you. We hope you enjoyed the show. And look at our website to see the shows that are coming up in the next moment. We have a lot of